10 years. That's how long I've been a YouTuber. In this video, I'm gonna share with you guys my 10-year YouTube story. Way back in 2006, there was this hilarious video that everyone was sharing. It was of these two Chinese guys lip-syncing to Backstreet Boys. If you guys didn't know, it was actually the success of this lip-sync video that compelled Google to buy YouTube. It was this video that also inspired me to film my own attempt at lip-syncing back in 2007. My first year as a YouTuber. I'm pretty sure I took a total of 25 takes to get the timing just right. I shared it with my friends, and they really enjoyed it. I was in university for business school at the time, but I was much more interested in music. Since I could beatbox, play the guitar, and sing, I decided to put all those skills together and cover Justin Timberlake's Cry Me a River. That was my first cover on YouTube. Even though I did this song way past the time the song was popular, my video performed pretty well. At the time, YouTube not only let users add comments below your video, but users could even add video responses. And so I got a lot of people responding with their versions of the song. I would get all these notifications like, "Do you want to allow this person's video to be displayed under your video?" And I was kind of a jerk and just went, "Nope. Nope, nope." But since I was still curious, I did watch most of them. One of those video responses was by this kid. I thought, hey, he's not that bad, but no way I'm gonna let him piggyback off of my traffic. Later on, I found out that this kid got discovered, and now he's a huge pop star. For the next little while, I experimented with a bunch of different things, and I continued to use YouTube casually as a convenient tool to share my creative projects with my friends. But out of all the creative things that I did at the time, I was most passionate about songwriting. So I moved to Korea to see what opportunities that I could find there. And after a year of meeting with all the big important people in the industry and having no real luck getting picked up, I decided to change my course and pursue music independently through YouTube. And that was my third year as a YouTuber. But how was I going to pursue music through YouTube? Well, it looked like all the YouTube musicians that I followed at the time, like David Choi, were all making covers of popular songs. So I thought, that's what I gotta do too. But I knew that I needed to differentiate myself because unlike David Choi and many of the other big YouTube musicians, my voice nor my live guitar playing skills was that strong. What I was good at, that you wouldn't really see much on YouTube back then, was electronic music production. So I committed myself to releasing a cover once a week. This was a lot of work on top of the full-time job that I already had at the time. Even though I was in Korea, I would always have LA's Kiss FM radio playing in the background. Even though I didn't care about so many of the pop musicians that I followed, I religiously kept up with their tweets so that I wouldn't miss any announcements of new songs. With no access to a smartphone or a tablet back then, I had to memorize lyrics to entire songs every moment that I wasn't working. For an entire week, I would arrange layers upon layers of music in my production software, and my entire Saturday would be dedicated to filming myself again and again until I had the perfect one-shot take while the sun was still out to give me good enough lighting. This routine took over my life, and it was not fun at all. I was spending so much time making renditions of songs that I hated, like California Girls by Katy Perry. California girls, they're unforgettable. They see Duke's bikinis on top. But I felt like I had to make it and get it out early to reap the benefits of early mover advantage. While this painful routine was not fun, I did see a very big increase in the number of my subscribers. So I just sucked it up and kept on going. In my fourth year as a YouTuber, I started to question, is there a way that I can make this more efficient and less painful? Right now, I'm releasing one song per week, But is there a way to cover more songs and release less frequently? And that's how I got started with singing medleys of songs with constantly changing instrumentals. 'Cause they got nothing on you, baby. Nothing on you, baby, no. What did you say? Oh, you're breaking up on me. Sorry, I cannot hear you. I'm kind of busy. And people loved it. Singing while harmonically mixing samples from the original songs was something not many YouTubers were doing at the time. I got a lot of good feedback with this kind of work. But I also got some requests to stop singing over them and just include the original voices. Not because they thought my singing was so terrible, but because they wanted to play my mixes in the bar or club setting. Maybe it was because they thought my singing was terrible. Anyway, I gave that a try and made my first mega mashup of the top popular songs of the year and called it Pop Danthology. My fans really enjoyed this project, so I decided to make it an annual thing. Around the same time, there was a Korean idol type of show that was inviting people all over the world to make a YouTube video of themselves singing K-pop for a chance to compete as a contestant on their show. I made a K-pop medley, and it ended up being the most viewed video out of all the submissions. Sorry, 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 내가, 내가, 내가 먼저 내게, 내게, 내게 빠져, 빠져, 빠져 버릴 baby. Poppy, 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 poppy. 아, 숨이 막혀, 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 내가 미쳐, 미쳐, baby. Get it, get it, get it, get it. Actually, a little bit of a secret here. My video was already doing pretty well on its own, but I wanted that extra push. So I asked one of my friends, who happens to be a K-pop idol, to tweet my video right from the point that the show was starting to count the views. Anyways, I got to be on the show and it was a pretty interesting experience. After that show, I went from having no luck getting picked up by the Korean entertainment industry to having a lot of professional interest and eyes on me. But instead of taking advantage of any of that, I gave up on everything and left Korea. I had to come back home to Canada because I needed professional help for my depression and addiction. So during the rest of my fourth and fifth year as a YouTuber, I put out very little content because I needed to focus on my recovery. Also, making YouTube videos and music was no longer fun for me. It just gave me stress. But on my sixth year as a YouTuber, I uploaded my Pop Danthology 2012. This video went viral all over the world.
Daniel Kim adındaki
Vancouver DJ Daniel Kim.
A viral video titled Pop Danthology 2012.
13 million hits.
Oh.
Canadian.
My inbox got so flooded with emails and messages that it took weeks to sift through all of them. I had to disable messaging on all my social media accounts because it was just all too much for me. A lot of the emails that I got were job offers from all over the world, including a job offer from one of the three major Korean entertainment companies that originally turned me down back when I was in Korea. People were prepared to fly me in, take care of my accommodations, and pay me good money. But because I was so unprepared for this, because I had not built up any kind of business structure for myself, and because I had just gotten settled with my comfortable, unrelated, dead-end part-time job, as dumb as it was, I pushed everything aside. With all my anxiety, I just couldn't handle it all. Things eventually settled down and I took some of those freelance jobs that came my way. Not being used to charging others for my services, I really undersold myself. But throughout the whole process, I learned a lot about doing freelance work, pricing, and preparing contracts. It finally took me until my seventh year as a YouTuber to question, what the heck am I still doing holding on to this part-time job that's forcing me to stay in my city? I no longer wanted to say no to all the many exciting out-of-town gigs. So in 2014, I went to my boss and told her that I want to quit. And that's how I became self-employed at the age of 29. So now I had all the time in the world to work on YouTube videos. Problem though, was that I was no longer excited about making music. I used to hear fully composed songs in my dreams. I used to have so many ideas around music, but now I couldn't hear anything. I think I must have killed all the music inside of me during my years in Korea, but I did have a lot of ideas around mental health and psychology. So I started a whole new YouTube channel called Talk Danthology for all of that. I also started sharing some of my life stories on my main channel. These videos got discovered and I started getting asked to fly into different conferences to deliver motivational speeches. I loved it. More than any musical performance I've done, I enjoyed speaking so much more. Through my 8th and 9th year as a YouTuber, I didn't put out much content on my main channel other than my annual mashups, which were already starting to get boring for me. Every year, my videos went viral, but I stopped caring about my views and number of subscribers. Somewhere along the line, I hit 1 million subscribers and YouTube sent me my gold play button. It was around this time that there were also many changes to YouTube's copyright policies. And in the process, my mashups became a free-for-all cash cow for all the record companies to make money off of. They put ads all over my videos, they blocked my videos from various countries, they forced some of my videos to be taken down, including my most viral mashup that had 80 million views, and they started issuing my channel copyright strikes. I was not happy about all of that. But I kept on going, and on my 10th year after getting married to my wife, we started a YouTube channel together called We The Kims, where we hope to document our memories, living life, having children, and growing old together. And that is my 10-year YouTube story. For most of those 10 years, I didn't know who I was apart from how I performed. So that definitely came out in my earlier videos. I was like a circus clown doing one trick after another. And then halfway through those 10 years, my channel became known for mashups, even though my channel was never just about mashups, and that's such a small part of what I do. It was just in my more recent years that I understood that there is much more to me than what I can do. And so that's why for the next chapter of my YouTube channel, I want to transition from pitching my skills and talents to pitching more of my personality and heart. I am aware that there's a lot of you who are subscribed to my channel only for mashups, but with all the copyright stuff that's going out of hand these years, if I continue to upload mashups, I run the risk of possibly losing my channel. So as long as copyright policies remain this restrictive for mashup artists, Pop Danthology, I'm sorry, will no longer be an annual thing. If you guys want to unsubscribe because of that, I'm totally okay with that. But for everyone else, I assure you that there's much more creativity within me, and I'm excited to share that with you guys. Thank you.